Good morning, or should I say good afternoon, good evening, wherever you may be joining us from around the globe. We want to warmly welcome each and every one of you to this virtual conference that has been organized by Aglow International Sri Lanka. We warmly welcome our global audience and very specially our sisters from Aglow Asia. What a glorious celebration we are going to have as we all come together to exalt and to lift up the name of Jesus. We are going through some very challenging and distressing times in our nations. There is turbulence, turmoil, chaos, confusion, despair, and hopelessness. But aren't you glad that despite what is raging around us, that we can lift up our eyes unto the King who is enthroned above? He is clothed in majesty, power, and honor, and he reigns. You know, Psalm 29 says, the Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord is enthroned as King forever. So we want to make a bold declaration over this conference that Jesus is King. He is King forever. He is reigning in power and he is ruling. How reassuring to know that in the midst of all that is going on around us, that we have an anchor that holds us steady in the storms of life. The writer to the Hebrews put it this way. He said, we have this hope as an anchor for our souls, sure and steadfast. He talks about a hope. Hope is not a feeling. Hope is not dependent on circumstances, but it is based on the unchanging character of God and his faithfulness. And this hope never disappoints us. This hope never fails, because no matter what we see with our natural eyes, God is at work in the spiritual realm to accomplish his eternal purposes. I believe that this is also a time of transition, where God is repositioning us to be the watchman over our nations and over our families, to dismantle every power of darkness, and to break down every stronghold that enslaves the minds of people, and to release God's kingdom, rule, and reign into every situation that was against the purposes of God. So where there is chaos and strife, we speak peace, justice, and righteousness. So over these 2 days, we invite you to come and dine at the banqueting table that the Lord has prepared for us. It's a table for two, Jesus and you. And there is mercy, there is forgiveness, and there is healing for the broken heart. So it will be a time of healing, restoration, and renewal. And even as our speakers bring to us the life-changing and life-transforming power of God's word, let's keep our hearts open and allow the Holy Spirit to work in our hearts to bring change and transformation. So we invite you to join us for all the sessions. We have an evening session from 6:30 to 8 local time. And just be blessed by all what the Lord has in store for us. So wherever you are, can I kindly ask you to please stand, because we are going to come into the presence of the Almighty God, and we are going to lift up this conference to God in prayer. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, even as we bow in your holy presence, Lord, we acknowledge you as the sovereign Lord over the universe. Lord, you are our maker. You are the creator of heaven and earth. Lord Jesus, we thank you because you are the unchanging one. Lord, the ageless one. Lord, the eternal God. Lord, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Lord, you are the God of the generations. Lord, the God who led our forefathers. Lord, you are leading us, Lord, even today. Lord, you are our rock. You are our refuge, our fortress, and a present help in trouble. Lord, even as we are living in these turbulent times, Father, we thank you that we can just take our eyes off all that is happening and just lift up our eyes to your throne of grace, throne of mercy, where you are reigning and ruling. Lord, we worship you. We worship you. And Lord, this morning, we just want to lift up this conference into your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, we welcome you into our midst, that you would come and brood over each one of us. Lord, brood over every participant. And Lord, you know the struggles that they are going through. Lord, you know the fears, Lord. Lord, you see their brokenness, O God. And Lord, we pray that you will minister to every heart, Lord, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you will come like the dew. Lord, to fall afresh upon us. Lord, to refresh us, to renew us. Lord, take away the tiredness, take away the weariness, O God. And Lord, quicken us by the power of your Spirit. Lord, come, Holy Spirit, like the fire. And Lord, we pray you will purify our hearts, O God. Lord, for you are seeking a people, Lord, who are holy, who are set apart for you, through whom you can establish your eternal purposes, O God. So we welcome you, Holy Spirit, that you will come and do a work in our hearts. Lord, we just thank you for your servants, O God. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the way you have prepared them for this conference. Lord, we thank you for the word that you have laid on their hearts, O God. And Lord, even as they bring to us, Lord, the life-changing and life-transforming truths of God's word, Lord, we pray that we will be anchored to the unchanging truth of your word. And Lord, that our lives will be changed. And so, Lord, we lift up this conference to you. And Lord, we pray that even as we enter into times of worship, Lord, as we lift up and exalt the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray that you will be enthroned in the praises of your people and you will take your rightful place. So, Lord, we bless you, we praise you, and Lord, we just commit this conference into your loving hands. For we have prayed and asked all this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Good morning. 1979 was a significant year. And why was it so significant? Because the late Mrs. Sylvia Veerasinghe found a president led by the Holy Spirit, birthed the Womens’Aglow Fellowship in Sri Lanka. Now, this began as a single group, but soon grew in leaps and bounds to many parts of Sri Lanka. And so, it has been a long journey. Auntie Sylvia, as we fondly remember her, was instrumental in training women and in building us up to be effective leaders in the Aglow. 2019, now it's a long journey, so 2019 was glorious year when we celebrated 40 years of Aglow in Sri Lanka. And at this celebration, we honored those who had served this ministry of Aglow for 25 years or more. And it was indeed a glorious, glorious celebration. It's time now that the Generations Youth Choir, headed by Mrs. Ruwani De Singha, she's the director of the Generations Choir, and they would be singing the hymn for Sri Lanka, penned by Walter Stanley Sr., who is a Britisher, British national. And this hymn has a prophetic proclamation over our nation, Sri Lanka. So even as this hymn is being sung, I would ask you kindly to stand wherever you are in honor of our nation, Sri Lanka.
Jehovah, thou hast promised thee. The People's Church worship team, now lead us in a time of worship. And as the Word of God says, the Lord indwells in the midst of the people's praises. So wherever you are, please feel free to join in and worship the Lord and get connected to Him.
There are many ladies joining us today from all over the world. So I think I should say good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Wherever you are today, we want to invite you to worship the Lord and to lift your praise to Jesus Christ, who is our shepherd and who is our rock that never moves in our life. You know, there are so many things that change in our life. People may leave, but the Lord is always constant in our lives, and we want to proclaim that today. So please join me. Feel free to clap your hands, lift your praise to the Lord Jesus, and say,
there is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved is proving himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like us.
One more time, there is no rock.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God.
Amen. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Thank you, Jesus. For the Lord is good. His loving kindness is everlasting. Isn't that a lovely, lovely promise the Lord has given you and I? And today we are going to proclaim that. One, two, three. God is so good. One more time. One, two, three. God is so good. Okay, we are going to sing this song. It talks about the goodness of God, and it says, no height or depth can separate the love that God has for you and for me.
No height or depth can separate your steadfast love. We can escape your faithfulness and endless sea, so full of grace.
Lord, you never change, you never move. In Christ alone, we put our strength and we put our hope. In Jesus' name, thank you, Jesus.
Is my life, my strength.
when darkness seems.
Spirit in our midst. It's my great pleasure to introduce our first speaker today. She's none other than Alice Tsoi, the National President of Aglow International, Greater China. She's also the Aglow Asia Regional Committee Chairperson. She's no stranger to us. She has blessed us many times at our conferences here in Sri Lanka, and she's very much part of the Aglow Sri Lanka. And she has been involved in Aglow ministry for over 30 years. And her greatest passion is to raise up leaders for the kingdom wherever she goes. She's committed to worship, prayer, and kingdom empowerment of believers. So her deepest desire is to see men and women experiencing the deeper intimacy with the Father and to see them walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. We are in for something great today. As the speakers will speak to us about what the Lord has laid in her heart for such a time as this, let's be all ready to receive it. Let's welcome Alice Tsoi from Greater China region. Thank you.
Good morning, Sri Lanka. And I know there are many nations who have joined this virtual conference. It's just so wonderful to be with you. Thank you, Surani, for the lovely introduction. Thank you. You know, I have just been so blessed already. I was so blessed when the generations were singing that hymn. It's just so beautiful. You know, I was asking the Lord, so Father, how do you see Sri Lanka? And he pointed me to the shape of your nation. You know, it's like a tear. And I felt, he said, he has seen your tears. And your tears have become his tears. And he has shed those tears for you. And he's changing those tears into precious jewels. See, that tear shape has become the shape of the jewel. And you have so many precious jewels in Sri Lanka. So I feel this is what God is saying. That he is moving you on. He's bringing you to a new place. You will go forth with much strength and joy from these days. Because God has something great for your nation. And through Aglow, many people, many leaders will be raised up. Many men and women will be raised up through the ministry of Aglow in Sri Lanka. This is powerful what God is doing. And I'm just so excited for you. I bless you. I thank you for inviting me to share with you today. You know, the Holy Spirit is drawing us to a new place these days. So I believe every Aglow conference is a strategic conference. So you are here today because God has drawn you here. The Holy Spirit has drawn you here because he wants to impart something to you through these messages. We are living, you know, we are living in very interesting times. Things that's never happened before is happening before our eyes. But we need to see the big picture. You know, we cannot be so bogged down with what's happening these days. You know, those little things, we have to see God's bigger picture. So I'm very excited with this conference theme, Anchored to the Rock. It's such a great theme. And before I go into my message, I want to share with you some of the things that God has been saying to Aglow. And I would like to share my PowerPoint first. Okay. All right. Okay, let's see. Okay, so this is our theme, Anchored to the Rock. So some of these things that God has been saying to Aglow. This back a few years ago, he says, I give you the keys. Through Dutch sheets, he gave us this word. We have been given the keys to bind and loose, to open and shut. from Isaiah 22:22. And this is what we have been doing in our prayers, when we use the keys. And later on, I think tomorrow you'll be hearing from Nancy McDaniel. And Nancy has been doing some prayer training with the Aglow Asia leaders. And she said, use the keys, right? So we have been using keys in our prayers. Okay, next. Let me go back. Okay, next one is we are apostolic and prophetic watchmen. God has been saying to us, we are apostolic and prophetic watchmen. So that has changed the way we pray. But we are not praying functional prayers anymore. We are praying relational prayers because we are seeing what God is seeing and we are declaring what He wants us to declare. Now, because I haven't got a lot of time, so I'll go through these things very quickly. Three, we have come full circle and at a higher level. So if you notice that some of the things in your Aglow groups, maybe what you're doing is like doing the same thing, but no, it is like coming full circle, but we are going at a higher level. Amen. Aglow is an eternal ministry. Now, Jane Hansen Hoyt, our international president, talked about this. Aglow is an eternal ministry. We have played an eternal part in God's ultimate plan. For example, our mandates. That is part of God's eternal plan. And number five, we will be part of the third great awakening. Now you have been hearing, if you have been receiving Aglow's emails and Jane's Friday videos, this is constantly being mentioned now, the third great awakening. That is talking about an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The third day talks about resurrection power. And later on in my message, I'm going to share how we can prepare for this third great awakening, how we can position ourselves to be part of this third great awakening. See, all these are very strategic words, but we have to really grasp the full impact of these words. Now, you cannot be just be hearing and think, oh, this is very nice, now this is good. What does it actually mean for me personally? And what does it mean for us as a corporate body? We need to grasp the full impact. And really, to be honest, we haven't really understood all the meaning of it because God has been unfolding the understanding of these words to us. So the first thing we need to do is we have to believe what God has said about us. And then we begin to grasp slowly what He's saying to us and walk in those things. All right. So we are talking about being anchored to the rock. I'm going to give you five keys today on how to be anchored to the rock. Just to help us, okay? Now, some of these things you know already, but I want you to really grasp it deep into your spirit today, that you will not just know it in your head, but understand in the spirit and begin to really live your life. Your lifestyle starts to change. The first key is about having a steadfast heart. Now, steadfast simply means being fixed, being steady, right? And being firm. It means you're not moving here and there. You're fixed, you're steady. So you ask yourself, is my heart troubled? In John 14:27, Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do do not let your heart be troubled and do not be afraid. Are you afraid of the pandemic? Have you been troubled by financial crisis? What about marriage relationships, health problems, or even natural disasters that you're seeing? Are you troubled? Is your heart troubled? You know, sometimes we get very easily troubled about little things. So this is a time to prepare ourselves to have a steadfast heart. Are you secure in your relationship with God? Now, I'm not talking about, oh yes, I believe in Jesus. Jesus died for me. I believe in the cross. I believe in the resurrection. It's more than that. You know, when you are secure in your relationship with God, it's talking about a level of trust, faith, and knowing Him. What is your level of knowing Him now? Have you increased in your knowledge of Him? Is your faith stronger than last year? No, move and move towards greater level to be secure in your relationship with Him. To know that whatever happens, He's my God. He will not forsake me. He will not leave me as an orphan. Now, in Hong Kong, there was a Christian lady, and she really suffered losing family members one after another. And sadly, she doesn't believe in God anymore because she thinks God is so cruel. You see, that's the kind of thing you have to ask yourself. Even if I lose somebody close to me, do I still trust Him? Do I still believe in Him? Do I still know that He is in control of everything? And you know that God is steadfast towards us. In fact, His steadfast love gives us, you know, enables us to have a steadfast heart. I said it once again. The steadfast love of God enables me to have a steadfast heart. You know, because I see Him, how He is towards me, so I can be safe towards Him. In Psalms 112, 6 and 7, this is what it says. Surely the righteous will never be shaken. They will be remembered forever. They will have no fear of bad news. Their hearts are steadfast, trusting in the Lord. No fear of bad news. You will not be shaken if your heart is steadfast, trusting God. This is so important for these times. Because of the pandemic, it's so uncertain what is happening. You hear about the virus variants, and it's just so mysterious. We don't know where it's appearing, when it's popping up, you know. But our heart needs to be steadfast towards God. Our heart needs to say, God, whatever happens, You are in control. Do you, at this moment, still believe that God is in control? God is still on the throne. Amen. Ezekiel 36:26. God says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. He's saying, I want to remove your heart from that stony condition. You see, a heart of stone means it's hardened. And a heart of flesh means it's soft, right? Now, what happens? When do we harden our hearts? What causes the hardness of heart? There's several things. There's unbelief, this doubt, this fear, anxiety, depression, or you look to the world's wisdom, can give you a heart of stone and harden your heart. See, when your heart is hard, when your heart is hard, hardened, then nothing can get in because it's so hard. But when it's soft, it can absorb love, absorb all that God wants to give you. So do your quick check. Where is your heart right now? Where is your heart? Is your heart in doubt right now? Is your heart in fear? Is your heart in anxiety? Or just trusting the world's ways? Where is it right now? It's a good time to check your heart. I like this verse in Romans 8:38 from the Passion Translation. So now I live with the confidence that there is nothing in the universe with the power to separate us from God's love. I'm convinced that His love will triumph over death, life's troubles, fallen angels, or dark rulers in the heavens. There is nothing in our present or future circumstances that can weaken His love. Isn't that amazing? And I want to declare it over you right now. Right? Put your hand on your heart. I'll declare this over you. So now you live with the confidence that there is nothing in the universe but the power to separate you from God's love. You are convinced that His love will triumph over death, life's troubles, fallen angels, or dark rulers in the heavens. There is nothing in your present or your future circumstances that can weaken His love for you. Amen. Receive it. Amen. So that was the first key, to have a steadfast heart. The second key is to understand Satan's strategies. We know the enemy is working overtime now because he knows his days are numbered. But we need to be aware of what he's doing, and we need to understand his strategies. I know, I don't know about you, for the past week, the Olympics have been on, and I've been watching some of those team games. And I noticed how the player, what do you have to understand the enemy's, the opponent's tactics to be able to win the game, right? So they are very alert. So I think it's the same for us. You know, we got to understand what the enemy wants to do. We cannot be blind or blurred to what he's doing. I know one of the things he wants to do is to separate. He wants to separate you. He wants to separate the church. He wants us to be separated from God. Full stop. That is his key strategy. John 10:10, you know the famous verse, right? And Jesus says, I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. But the enemy, what does he do? He comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He wants to steal our possessions, our gifts, our spiritual gifts. He wants to steal that. And even, you know, our financial things, he wants to steal. You know, that's why you have people lose a lot of money. And through scams, you know, there's so many scams happening these days. People losing millions of dollars because they were involved in a scam. They got tricked. So we are God's people. We need to be smarter than anyone else because we have the mind of Christ. He wants to kill your body. All right, he wants to attack your mind. So he wants to give you poor health. So you got to understand what he's trying to do, and you move against what he's trying to do. If you have a weak body because of your own doing, and you're not eating well, you're not sleeping well, or you're not exercising, you begin to change and not live that lifestyle anymore. And he wants to destroy your faith and your relationships. That's what he's trying to do. So are you aware of what the enemy is doing? Are you aware of what the enemy is trying to kill, steal, and destroy in your life? Understand his strategies. And he wants to deceive us. Oh, he just wants to deceive us all the time. And he does it in these four things I've listed here. He does this to a religion. I know the Bible talks about many will be deceived in the last days. Many will be deceived in the last days. I don't want you to be deceived. I don't myself to be deceived. You know, when you just practice religion, which is a set of rules and regulations, and there's no relationship with God, then you're very likely to be deceived. Because it is within that relationship with God that the Holy Spirit begins to show us when you're walking or thinking or believing in wrong things. You know, he will put a check in our spirit. But if you are just being religious, right, just going to church, doing Bible study, but you don't have an intimate relationship with God, and you're very prone to deception. This is something very important. He will use doubt, doubting God's word, and using false doctrine to make you think, well, is this really what God wants, is saying or wants me to do? It's the same way he did with Adam and Eve, right? Putting doubts in their mind. So check your doubts recently. Have you been doubting anything? Check it and see where that doubt comes from. Is it the Holy Spirit giving you discernment about something? Or is the enemy using this to deceive you? Counterfeit. Fake news. How many of us understand fake news? There's so much fake news for the past year. Even fake dreams and visions. You know, I received so many WhatsApp messages from people this last year about the pandemic, about things, and people had say having dreams or visions. You know, they can be counterfeit. They cannot, sometimes they're not real. So we need to have discernment these days. And discernment can only be possible if you have a right relationship with God. Because discernment is out of the heart of God. Right? Holy Spirit bringing the revelation to you, give you that discernment, and you get a check in the spirit. Doesn't sound right to me. Let me check this out. Let me think about it. Let me ask the Lord about this. See, when you are in that relationship with God, you're always talking to the Lord. You're always asking him how he sees this thing, what he's thinking, how do I pray about this, right? The relationship is so important. And the next thing is he uses pride. And I don't need to talk about this, right? Like people think, oh, I'm so good, I know everything. No, it's so easy to go into deception. And he deceives you to bring you to self-deception. You cannot even see you're being deceived. You begin to have a wrong belief of yourself. right? When you have self-deception, you think wrongly about yourself, and you don't acknowledge your sin, you know, your wrongdoing, and you think you're right all the time. Well, self-deception makes you proud, right? You don't think anything is wrong with you or what you've said is wrong. You believe lies and you turn away from the truth. Self-deception is really in denial of the truth. So we have to be so careful not to be deceived by the enemy. And then the enemy comes like an angel of light. Bible tells us that the enemy, Satan, disguises himself as an angel of light. Many Christian articles, messages sound so good, appealing. And then he will use to lead our thinking to replace God with him. So in other words, no, everything about God becomes everything about Satan, about him. So that is his strategy, the angel of light. What you think about God becomes what you think about the enemy. But you don't see it like that. You don't say, oh, this is Satan, this is God. You have replaced that thinking, because this angel of light, you're thinking it is from God, but it's not, it's the enemy. So he is trying to deceive you to think that it's God. And he enjoys that when you put the focus on him, the glory given to him. Now he wants to take God's glory. That's what he wants to do. So how can we see this angel of light is not from God? Again, it's discernment, but the other thing, very important, is to have a pure heart. Jesus says, blessed are those who are pure in heart, for they will see God. If you want to see God, pure heart is the key. And you can then know this is not from God, but God will show you himself to you. The third key is to identify your fears. Many of us are so fearful. Your fear of lack, fear of death, fear of losing loved ones, and even fear of people. You see, fear of lack is what you have, what you don't have. No, because your fear of the future. And then fear of death is, am I going to die from this pandemic? Am I going to contract this virus and die from it? Or you just fear of losing loved ones. Someone has got the virus, and you fear of losing them. And of course, we don't want to lose them. But there's a place where you have to let go and give it to God. Because then you're trusting God. So when you fear of losing the loved ones, are you putting that loved one above God? And that person becomes your idol. You know, in this pandemic, I cannot visit my mother. My mother is in another country. And she's really 95. And I'm thinking, what will happen if she contracts the virus and I don't get to see her and I lose her? You know, I had that in my mind too. But then I began to go to God and say, Lord, you know the days of her life. You know when I can go back to see her. I'm just to let go and completely trust you and give it to you. And then I'm at peace. I don't have to worry anymore. Because I know God knows. God knows my heart. God knows the timing. Fear of people is actually fear of man. Your fear of man causes you to compromise your faith in God. Fear of man means you are so worried about what people think of you, how people see you, and you will think, I have to do this for this person, otherwise they don't like me. I have to oblige this person. So you're going with the flow. That is fear of man. If you go with the flow and not willing to stand up for something that's not right. Is it all these things, these four things, means that you're still operating from your old self. The fear is not the new self, the new man. God has taken all our fears, all our anxieties away. He said, give it to me. I'm in control. So we trust him. But we need to identify our fears. Where is it that I still have fear? Where is it that I haven't given it to him? Where is it that I'm still operating in my old self? 2 Timothy 1:7 says, you know, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. And, you know, fear weakens our immune system. So we don't want, these days, to have a weak immune system. You want to have a strong immune system, yes? To fight against this virus. And it accelerates aging. You know, as women, we don't do let people see that we're getting old, right? It's not that we're not getting old, but we don't want to accelerate it by being fearful. So we need to be very strong in our identity in Christ, right? And understand that it's perfect love that casts out all fear. See, when we are strong in our identity of who Christ is, what he's done for me and what he is to me, see, that perfect love will cast out all fears. And God is so good. He gives us all these promises. But we need to grasp hold of these things. Amen? Okay, let's move on. Number four, the fourth key. Follow the wind of the Spirit. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, we used to play a game called The Wind Blows, and somebody says something, all those who are wearing red, and everyone would go to, right, the person with the red, right? And so it's a kind of like that. See, when the Spirit is blowing, we just follow. And you know that Aglow is Spirit-born and Spirit-led. We are following the Holy Spirit all the time. But you've got to practice it. Sometimes we forget. When you follow the wind of the Spirit, we are not afraid of change. Right? The Holy Spirit will blow in a different direction. Are you afraid to go there? No, I'm not sure. You know, that's the way for me. Or if the Holy Spirit says, okay, let's do this thing this way this time. Are you afraid? Are you uncomfortable to move? Obedience is needed. God desires our obedience better than our sacrifices. But you may sing and praise till the cows come home, but you don't obey the Holy Spirit, it's no use. Right? Your life won't move. You'll be stuck. Set our sails. Now this is interesting because in the Olympics, one of the events was a sailing event. And I noticed the people, how they set their sails, you know, to catch the wind, get them faster in their track. So when we know how to set our sails, it will determine our direction. When you know how to set your sails to the wind, it will determine your direction. Because that is the direction the Holy Spirit is going and you're following that. Be in unity with others. This is the time, you know, the enemy is trying to separate us, as I said just now. In Hong Kong, you've heard what has been happening in our society. There's such a split in the churches, split in the families. This is a time we need to draw together to be in unity with others. You know, this conference really stirs my heart, because although this is the Sri Lankan conference, but I'm seeing people from different nations in Asia, and even I think the UK are joining. And there's such a coming together. And I think this is very important these times, the coming together, the gathering of God's people. Wherever we are, you know, this is such a precious time. You know, we have been experiencing separation, social distancing, and lockdown. But this kind of conference will draw us together and bring those hearts together. So thank you, Sri Lanka, for doing this. Just wonderful. Hallelujah. Remember that at the day of Pentecost, it says they were gathered together. They were gathered in obedience, because that was what Jesus told them, right? To stay, wait. They obeyed. And then they set their sails, and then they caught the wind of the Spirit. What was the result? They ushered in a new era. The New Testament church was born. So I believe when we catch the wind of the Spirit and obey, we will bring in something new. God has always something new for us. And we know Aglow has moved to a new era. It's a new season. Are we living in that new season, or are we still back in the old? We want to follow the Spirit, what He's saying. Last key number five, share your story. Now, why have I put this in? Why is this so important to be anchored to the rock? See, in Revelations 12:11, it says, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives even unto death." See, the word testimony is from a judicial setting, meaning a witness, giving evidence. So when we share our story, we are giving evidence of what God is doing. We are a witness for Christ. And in Acts 2, actually, it says, you know, Jesus says, stay until the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. So the Holy Spirit is the one who empowers our witnessing. And your story is going to be powerful, because the Holy Spirit will put that power into your story. It's going to touch lives. And when you share your story, you're actually declaring and proclaiming who He is. So that is powerful. It's not talking about yourself, or how bad I am, or how God changed me, or how good I am now. No. Yes, that is part of it. But that goodness is declaring Him and proclaiming who He is, that good God, that miracle-working God, that powerful God. See, that will come with the anointing that the Holy Spirit will give you when you share your story. When you share your story, you are keeping your eyes on Him. You're focusing on Him, what He's doing, not what the world is doing, what I am doing. So you're focusing on Him all the time. So in these difficult times, uncertain times, when you share your story, you are being anchored to the rock, being firm, because you are hearing yourself saying out loud who He is for you. And you're strong and firm, and you will influence others. Amen. You know, when we are sharing our story, we will be frustrating the enemy. He doesn't like us, right? He doesn't like us to declare who God is and proclaim who God is, or keep our eyes on God. But when we do it, we're going to frustrate Him. We're going to frustrate the accuser of the brethren. See, in the previous verse, in verse 10, it says, the accuser of the brethren, day and night, is accusing us. But when we declare who God is, we are frustrating him. And he has no more right, and he has no more strength to accuse us. So keep our eyes on him, share our story, keep exalting him. In Psalm 71 and Psalm 145, it talks about declaring his goodness, how to declare God's goodness. I love that song, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. And the chorus goes, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. What is your story today? Do you have a story to share? Well, when you are having lunch later, share your story with somebody. Tell them who God is in your life, how good he has been for you. So the five keys, to just quickly review, the first one is to have a steadfast heart. Number two is to understand Satan's strategies. Number three, identify your fears. Number four, follow the wind of the Spirit. And number five, share your story. The third great awakening. How to position ourselves for the third great awakening. We have heard that the glow is made for chaos. I don't know how many of you have heard that. I think it was one of the global conferences. Possibly it was Graham Cook who says this. A glow is made for chaos. What does that mean? It means we thrive in crisis. When chaos and crisis comes, we, the Aglow people, will thrive because we know what God wants us to do. We will not be shaken. We will not pull back, but we are going to go forward in strength. We are the apostolic prophetic watchmen positioned in the gates of our nations, declaring what God wants us to declare, prophesying the word of God. Okay. Three things to position ourselves for the third great awakening. Alignment, I'm going to talk about the two builders and to come up higher. Alignment with him and his plans. We have to get our lives right into alignment with him. I remember the story of David. You remember when David went back to Ziklag, he discovered that he's lost his wives. The enemy has taken his wives. And not just him, it's all the men's wives too were taken away. So they were crying and wailing, and David's men began to blame David and says, no, this is your fault, you know, that our wives are being taken. They wanted to stone him. But what did David do? David says that David found strength in the Lord. David found strength in the Lord. And he asked God, what shall I do? Shall I go and fight and go after these enemies? And God said, go, I will be with you. You see, David begins to align himself to God's plans and God's will. When things begin to happen in our lives, because we are moving towards that great awakening time, there will be crisis, chaos, things will happen. We begin to align ourselves with God's plans. God, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to go up? Do you want me to stay put? See, this is a time we practice hearing the voice of God even more. The two builders, you know the parable of the two builders in Matthew 7? I found it interesting. You know, the background of the story, the biblical scholars believe that the background of this parable was in Bethsaida, right? Bethsaida is near Galilee. And you know, Galilee is the birthplace of Philip, Andrew, and Peter. And the soil there is called hard alluvial sand. It's hard alluvial sand. But when the rains come, the Jordan River would overflow and loosen up the hard sand and make it unstable. See, therefore, if somebody wants to build, they have to dig deep into the bedrock for the solid foundation. So the two builders that Jesus talked about actually started in the same place. They both started on the sand, right? But it was the wise builder who dug deep, who went to the solid foundation, to the bedrock. The foolish builder only looked at the present and said, oh, it's okay now, you know, that's fine, it's hard, I can build my house here. You know, and thinking everything is okay. So he has a really shallow faith. The wise builder looks to the future. What's going to come? He knows that when the rains come, this sand will loosen. So that's why he needs to dig deep. And so Jesus says, be like the wise builder. That means you not just be a listener, but a doer of the word. And it says here, see, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like the wise man who built his house on the rock. And what is he referring to? Hears these words of mine. Because I know he is talking before that, the Beatitudes, you know, the Sermon on the Mount, all those words about seek, knock, about the narrow gate, about having faith, about fasting, about not worrying, about judging others, all these words. So practice those. So do these words of mine. Put them into practice and become like the wise builder. Because when the shaking comes, you are strong. You won't be shaken. Look to the future. Prepare for the storm. A listener and a doer of the word will prepare for the storm. For some time, we have been hearing the word come up higher. In Jerusalem, Asher and Traitor talked about this. Come up higher. God is inviting us to come up higher. It means a door is open to a glow to come up higher, to see what he has for us. So we are seeing everything from God's position, God's perspective, and we seek his wisdom in all our circumstances. This is a time to practice that. God is giving many things in our lives, many situations to help us put into practice. Practice hearing what he wants to do. You know, practice seeking his wisdom. Practice just staying close to him, being quiet, and meditating on his word. So in conclusion, do you believe that Aglow is a light to the world? But Jane Hansen said, the point of darkness is to release light. You know, darkness is coming to the face of the earth. well, many places has come. A glow is a light for the world. And the point of darkness is to release that light. So when we are in dark situations, release that light, and the darkness will not overcome it. We will overcome it. I believe that the pandemic and the past year and all these things as a preparation for boldness, for us to be bold, bold in witnessing, bold in proclaiming the word, and bold in prayer. I mean, when we come into that third great awakening, many things will happen. You know, the Holy Spirit is going to be poured out, and you're going to see miracles. Now, when a sick person comes to you, are you bold enough to pray and see this person being healed and raised up? See, this is a time for us to practice this boldness. And you choose to be anchored. It is not an automatic thing. This is the choice. But today, make the choice to be anchored to the rock. Anchored to him. See, and check your anchor right now. Is your anchor on the rock or on sand? Are you looking at just what's happening now, or are you looking to the future? May God bless you as you think about these truths and these five keys I've given you, and may you be firmly anchored to the rock and not be shaken. And I would love to hear testimonies from you. Amen. So let's pray. Father, thank you that you are in our lives, that you are in control of every situation, that we can trust you no matter what happens. Father, I just want to bless everyone here listening this conference, that you will begin to give them revelation of who you are. If there has been sadness, there has been suffering, Father, let them know that you care, and you will change their mourning to dancing, that you are the God, the Father, who cares about everything in their lives. And Lord, I just pray that the light in them will just shine forth even brighter. And in the midst of darkness, let that light permeate through the darkness. Let that light show people the way and say, this is my God. I am not afraid. So Father, I just bless everyone here. Thank you. Thank you for calling them and that they are your children. Thank you that you have such a plan for each one of us and the destiny. And Lord, I bless Aglow Sri Lanka. Yes, you gave me that word just now, to move from strength to strength, go into more strength and joy in the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Alice, for refreshing and renewing our thoughts and giving us the five keys, stirring our hearts as we continue to journey anchored to the rock. Now it is my great pleasure to introduce a special couple who has journeyed with your glow and has been a great strength and encouragement to us. They have lovingly supported us whenever we reached out to them. So we warmly welcome Havi and Naomi Gunawardene, who will be doing a special for us. Be blessed.
God bless you, precious and beloved Womens’Aglow Fellowship. It is with great joy that we join you from our homes. I know this is a different time, a different season, and so much is done differently, but nothing can stop us from worshiping the Lord. Regardless of where we are together in his presence. Our Heavenly Father is with us right now. I want to encourage you and welcome you to worship the Lord together with us. God bless you. Since I found in him a friend so strong and true, I would tell you how he's changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cares. Every day he comes to me with new assurance. More and more I understand his words of love. But I'll never know just why he came to save me, till someday I see his blessed face above. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cares for me. For you and me. Oh, how much, precious child of God, he cares for you. There is none like you. Touch my heart like you do. I can search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. For all eternity long, and find there is none like you. Lord, your mercy flows like a river wide, and healing it comes from your hand. Suffering children, they are safe in your arms. There is none like you. Oh, oh, oh. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. Can't search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Will you sing with me one more time? There is none like you. There is none like you.
my heart like you do. I can search for all eternity long and find there is none. No, there is no one else. There is none like you. Nobody else like you. Nobody loves like you. No, 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 Lord, there is none like you. What a privilege to be cradled in the love of God. That is just where you are. Thank you so much for worshiping together with us. And thank you so much, Women's Aglow Fellowship, for having us today with you. God bless you. Goodbye.
It is my great joy and privilege to introduce to you our next speaker, Pastor Ayesha Ameresekere, who serves as Calvary Church Kirlipana for over 20 years. She has been greatly influenced and impacted by her godly grandmother, the late Mrs. Sylvia Veerasinghe, who birthed this ministry of Women's Aglow in Sri Lanka, as well as her godly parents. And so the legacy continues. She has a heart to see God's people rising up and fulfilling His call upon their lives. She journeys with them through their pain, their struggles, and challenges, and imparts strength and courage. She's also an author of A Godly Heritage and many more small Bible study group resources. She and her husband Sampath are blessed with three beautiful children. So we warmly welcome you, Pastor Ayesha, and we know we'll be richly blessed by the word of God. Over to you.
What an honor it is to be with you all as we gather virtually for the Women's Aglow Conference hosted in Colombo, Sri Lanka. Actually, from my teenage years, the Aglow Conference holds a very special place in my heart, as I've always come to experience the moving of the Holy Spirit, to just relax in the presence of the Lord and be refreshed by Him, as women of all walks of life have come together to experience God, and of course not forgetting the greetings, the smiles, and the laughter that happens when sisters in Christ gather together. Now, the conferences are always beautiful, all right, but it was made all the more special because I know from firsthand experience the fervent hearts, the primary place given to the Word of God, and the pursuit of sanctification and holiness in the lives of the women of Aglow. Aglow is not just a conference, but it's a day-to-day, week-by-week, moment-by-moment ministry that is impacting women, helping them to encounter Christ, and helping them to be a light in their generation by drawing others into the kingdom. And I just want to take a moment to honor and bless the National Board and every Aglow member, many of whom I know personally. I know their lives. I've seen Christ at work. I've seen them down on their knees praying. And I just want to thank you all for your exemplary lives and your ministry, which you have done for the sake of the call and invested in others. Quite honestly, never would I have imagined that I would one day stand here and share God's word. And I just want to say I consider it an inexplicable honor to have been entrusted with this. Thank you. And may the Holy Spirit enlighten us and move within us as we look at His word this morning. Our conference theme is Anchored to the Rock, And here we are, anchored to our rock, Jesus Christ. He's our rock, he's our fortress, and the very foundation of our lives. And today, I want to share with you all three marks of a woman who is anchored to the rock. A woman who is anchored to the rock is powerful in so many ways, because nothing about our power, nothing about our strength depends on who we are or where we come from or what we are humanly capable of. See, everything changes when we are anchored to the rock and when we find our source in Him and Him alone. Now, if you're a man and you're listening in this morning, you can always take the marks of a woman that I share and kind of turn it into a masculine way and apply it to yourself. However, I need to tell you that it might not work 100%, because I can tell you from experience that God has a special place in His heart for us women. So let's receive from Him. The first thing that I want to share today is that a woman who is anchored to the rock is fearless. She is a fearless woman. Now, in a natural sense, we all have fears, right? We are fearful about many things. And indeed, the state of our world has made us all fearless of things that we previously took for granted, made us fearful of things that we had never even thought about before. But we still all have these different fears, and these fears are kind of unique to all of us. Sometimes what cripples one person may not bother another person. And you know, something that we are not bothered about or something that doesn't worry us at all may be something that really grips someone else and makes their heart feel cold. But even though we have all these different kinds of fears, the word of God in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10 says this. Isaiah 41, 10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." When we look at the Bible, particularly in the book of Judges, we find this story about a woman named Deborah. Judges chapter 4 tells us this story. It was a dark and an oppressive time in the history of Israel. And there was this woman called Deborah who served as a prophetess, as a judge over Israel. Now, Deborah had a husband and his name was mentioned. His name was Lapidoth. But the word is clear that it was Deborah who was moving in her calling as a prophetess and a judge. So I wonder, why was Lapidoth's name mentioned? Was it just to show that he was in the picture? But he's not significant in this story. But perhaps God wants us to know that even women are called and set apart for the things of God. And just because one is appointed in a certain calling or in a certain role, it doesn't demean the other person in any way, but that we all have the freedom and the calling to move and serve in the area that God has destined for us. And it's not a competition. It's a calling, so let's move in our callings and not worry about the rest of it. But here we see Deborah in her prophetic authority. She summons Barak, who's a warrior, and gives him a message from God. And her message is that he should go into battle and he should go confidently because God was going to deliver the enemy into his hand. But at last, Barak was faint-hearted and fearful, and he told Deborah a very strange thing. He said, "I will not go unless you go with me, unless you accompany me." Now, strangely, we don't see Deborah here taking time to kind of convince Barak and egg him on and encourage him to do what he should do and tell him that, you know, God would be with him. But instead, we find her rising instantly and preparing herself to go with Barak. And all the while, she kind of reminds him that the glory of this victory would not go to him, but it would go to a woman because he had lacked the courage to obey God. And as the story goes on, we find Deborah coaching Barak in the battle strategy on the job, and he defeats the army just as God had promised. However, the commander, Sisera, escapes on foot, and he finds his way to a tent where there was a woman named Jael there, wife of Heber the Kenite. And Sisera thought that he had found a place of refuge and safety. And so he goes in and he asks for a drink of water, and he lies down and makes himself comfortable. But here we find another fearless woman. Jael fearlessly hammers a tent peg into his head, and so ends the oppression of King Jabin over the people of Israel. Now I want to ask you, does it come naturally for a woman to go into battle? Does it come naturally for a woman to overpower the commander of an army? Not at all. But you know what? When a woman is anchored to the rock and confident of God's word spoken to her, she becomes fearless and she is able to do mighty, mighty exploits for God. Now, as I read this story, I pray that God will not ask us to do this kind of mighty exploits, but nevertheless, He is calling us to be fearless women. In the next book in the Bible, the book of Ruth, this tiny little book, we find a woman, Ruth. She was a Gentile woman, and her husband had died, leaving her to be a widow. Her future looked bleak, to say the least. But at least in the land of Moab, from where she was, she would have had the security of her father's home, the support of her community, and the support of her religious community as well. Yet we find at a decisive point in her life, she fearlessly chose to follow Naomi, her mother-in-law, back to Bethlehem, to a land which was unknown and unfamiliar to her. And she made this wonderful declaration. Let me read it in Ruth chapter 1, verse 16. But Ruth said, "Entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go, and wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts you and me." By this statement that she made, "Your God will be my God," what was Ruth doing? She was anchoring herself to Yahweh, the living God, the God of Naomi. And as she anchored herself to the living God, she was able to fearlessly step out into the unknown. And we all know, looking at history, what God did and how He blessed Ruth because she took that fearless step. Now, being fearless as a woman of God doesn't necessarily mean the absence of fear in our lives. We have to understand and accept that fear is real. But you know what? God does not judge us or condemn us because we have fears. He doesn't hold our fears against us or mock us in our fearful moments. But a woman who is anchored to the rock is fearless because even in the face of fear, she chooses not to let fear dominate or determine her actions. She may feel like a mouse on the inside, but she stands on the word of God. She looks at the greatness of her God, and she fearlessly chooses to obey Him and walk the path that He has destined for her. And I tell you, God will never let down a fearless woman. His word keeps encouraging us to trust Him and not fear. The circumstances around us, our world, our environment, the things that are happening, the things that are not happening, may give us so many legitimate reasons to fear the future, to fear people, to fear even the opportunities and the doors that God opens for us. But God says, fear not, I am with you. Amen. And I pray that as women, we will learn to discern between the voice of God and a foolhardy attitude. Because being fearless doesn't mean that you just do whatever comes to your mind, you make out of context declarations from scripture, you disregard the wise counsel of people around you and just take foolhardy risks in the name of God. Being fearless means being so connected to the Lord on a moment-by-moment basis that you hear clearly from Him, like Deborah did. She heard clearly from God, so that even in fearful moments, you're able to rise above your fears and choose to obey the voice of God and trust Him above all else. Do you remember that poor widow in Luke chapter 21? Luke chapter 21, verse 1 says, "And he looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts into the treasury. And he saw also a certain poor widow putting in 2 mites. And he said, truly I say to you that this poor widow has put in more than all. For all these out of their abundance have put in offerings for God, but she out of her poverty has put in all the livelihood that she had." Now Jesus commended her offering because she gave all. So that means when she gave all, that she had nothing left. Can you imagine what a fearless act this was? Because it showed that she was so moved and so compelled to give everything to God, and she was so trusting of His ability to care for her and provide for her. So no fears about where her next meal would come from or where her next provision would be. She was fearless to God even in the act of giving. Now, does being fearless mean that one of the indicators that we are on the right path is that God will, you know, remove all our fears? I wish I could say that, but unfortunately neither the accounts of the saints in the Word nor our personal experience attest to that fact. There will actually be many moments where we will be exactly where God wants us to be, but we will be shaking and shivering on the inside. But I want to tell you something this morning. I want you to stand up like a champion. I want you to trample your fears and go on to do what God has destined for you. Because a woman who is anchored to the rock is fearless. And being fearless is not a feeling, it is a choice. Secondly, a woman who is anchored to the rock is secure. Now, what does a heavy anchor give to the ship? It gives the ship a sense of security. You're not going anywhere, no matter how furious the wind and the waves are going to be. Even though your ship may be tossed around a little bit, there is a boundary, there is a limit to this. The ship is secure because of its position in the anchor. Likewise, when we as women are anchored to Jesus, there has to come upon us a sense of security in every area of our lives. One is we have to be secure in who we are and what we look like, how we've been fashioned in His image, and that might be an area of struggle for all of us at different seasons of our lives. But Psalm 139 gives us His beautiful words, Psalm 139, verse 13, it says, "For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well." Sometimes we are concerned about the shape of our nose. Sometimes we are concerned about our weight. Sometimes we are concerned about the colors our hairs change as the seasons and the years go by. And we can do certain things to, you know, disguise our appearance, but there comes a point where all those efforts do become futile. So we have to become comfortable in our skin. We have to become secure in who we are and understand that that's how God made us. But not only should a woman find security in her physical appearance and knowing that God created her in His image, but we also have to be secure in who we are in Christ. You see, being anchored to the rock gives us an identity as a daughter of the Most High God. There is acceptance and unconditional love when we come into this father-daughter relationship. What happens? What happens is that we don't have to compete with anyone else for the Father's love and affection. We don't have to be better than anyone else to be noticed by Him. We don't have to impress other people with our skills or our gifts or our hospitality. But like Mary, we can sit at the feet of Jesus and be content and secure. We don't necessarily have to be busy like Martha, trying to put on a show or impress or get things done all the time. Let's look at this story in Luke 10. And I'm going to all these scriptures because I know Aglow women are women of the word. So I better base everything that I say firmly on the word of God. Luke 10 and verse 38 says, "Now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, 'Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me.' And Jesus answered and said to her, 'Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things. But one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which will not be taken away from her.'" Why did Jesus tell Martha, "Martha, Martha, you are troubled about many things"? Why Jesus said that was because our insecurities and our concerns sometimes trouble and worry us and cause us at that point to compare and contrast with other people. And at that point is where jealousy, dissatisfaction, and even fractured relationships become part of the body of Christ. Now, if Martha was serving God joyfully, and if she was secure in her part, she wouldn't have been bothered by what Mary was doing. But she was. She was irritated by Mary's rest because she was not secure in what she herself was doing. And I tell you, this is a much needed message for many women today. Because our world is teaching us that we have to be the best at everything, that we have to be the most popular, that we have to have the most number of friends, that we have to have the most likes, we have to have the most views, we have to be the most skilled, the most efficient, the best wife, the super efficient parent, the Wonder Woman who does everything and does everything perfectly without ever dropping the ball. That's the kind of pressure that our world is casting on women these days. But I want to tell you something. You can juggle as many balls as you like, but remember that God's not counting. And nothing that you can do can change His love and His acceptance and His view of who you are. You have to rest secure in Him. And you have to know that when you are anchored to Him, you are safe, you are secure, you are loved. So as women, we've got to find our place, we've got to know our place, we've got to get comfortable with our place. And then we've got to stop competing, stop striving, and stop climbing over others sometimes in our desperation to be first and best and most. Let's be women who are so secure in the Lord that we find our place in the kingdom and then we just rest securely in it. It may be big, it may be small, it may be visible, it may be invisible. I don't know what God has called you to do. Sometimes God calls people to do things that are really huge in His sight, but somehow these things are not seen by anybody. They will only be seen and recognized when we come face to face with our Master. And sometimes the lack of visibility might be something that bothers us, you know. We find that we're not recognized, or we're not appreciated, or we are not given a place that is comparable with the quota of work that we are putting in. But I want us to understand that we don't have to worry about those things, because everything, every hidden thing is visible to God. And so once you know your place, you can be secure in Him. Hallelujah. And finally, the woman who is anchored to the rock leaves a lasting legacy of faith. She makes it her life mission to pour out her faith into the lives of people around her so they can encounter Christ and grow in Him. She chooses to make regular spiritual deposits in the lives of those over whom she has influence. And one day when her earthly life is ended, there will be a legacy of love and faith that lives on in the next generation. And you know, this is what I have seen in Aglow. And I myself am standing here because of the lasting legacy of faith that has been deposited in me. The fragrance of a beautiful life that is well lived for the glory of God, it must live on long after our lives are ended here on earth. And this is something that God has uniquely gifted women to do, because we have an amazing power to influence others. Just think about the people that God brings across your path. Not just at this moment in time, but right throughout your journey. Think about the hundreds of people that have crossed your path and the opportunities that God has given you in different capacities to influence them and make spiritual deposits into their life. I tell you, it's mind-boggling. But these kind of things don't just automatically happen. We have to invest in others in an intentional, sacrificial, concrete way while we are here on earth. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates." So you see here, it's not just about prayers prayed in secret, but it's about intentional teaching, it's about intentional conversations, it's about a visible and primary place of honor given to the Word of God in one's home. When I was growing up, In our home, wherever the Bible was, if it was on a table, you don't put your feet on that table. If it was on a chair, you don't put your feet on that chair. You never keep the Bible on the floor. You never put anything on top of the Bible. Is it because there's something magical about this book? No, it's because in those visible ways, we were being taught the primacy, the supremacy of the Word of God, and that what is in this book is above all else. It reigns over our lives. Some of my most precious memories growing up are the intentional conversations about faith and spirituality that I had with my Nana. She didn't just pray in secret, although she did that all right, starting at 4 a.m. in the morning for many years, kneeling down on a cushion for hours and hours by her bedside. And she used to tell us, "Don't disturb me." But there were times that in our mischief, we just wanted to see how serious she was. And we would go and just start talking to see if her curiosity would get the better of her, but blanket ignore. If she was in prayer, you know, she didn't really care if the house was on fire. But beyond the prayers and beyond her moments with God, there were convicting conversations. And anyone who knew her knew that she found a way to insert the things of God, the Word of God, into every conversation. And there are these times when she would draw on the commands of God and bring it into our everyday life experiences and made sure we got it. We got it good. There were times that she would stop in the middle of a conversation to take it to the Lord in prayer. So here you're talking about something and suddenly she's like, "Let's pray," and she launches out into prayer, and mind you, even in public places. Apart from that, I would say that some of my most precious possessions are the Bibles and the devotional books that she left behind, which have her own personal prayers and markings in her crazily unreadable handwriting. And as I look at those and I see, you know, some of the, in the devotion books, just next to something she would write, "Yes, Lord," or "This is me, Lord, cleanse me, Lord." And when I read those things, it encourages me to draw near to God and to also talk to Him in that intimate and open way. So you see, it's not just something secret done between God and you, but it is a responsibility, an intentional act of leaving a lasting legacy of faith. And that responsibility to instruct, to teach families about the mighty attributes of God and the acts of God were resting on the adults. It was resting on those who had walked in His ways, who had experienced the goodness of God. If they had indeed tasted of the goodness of God, they were to talk about it, recount it, share it, and live it, so the next generation would know who Yahweh is. And even in the New Testament, in the book of 2 Timothy, we find Paul saying in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, "When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also, therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands." So Lois and Eunice had actively deposited their faith in young Timothy and brought him to a place of obeying God's call upon his life. So what a wonderful legacy of faith they had deposited in Timothy. So from the older to the younger, the faith and the lives and the gifts should be passed on and stirred up. Even in Titus, we find that the older women should teach the younger women, and here's another biblical command which we see being carried out so beautifully in the ministry of Aglow. You know, I want us to look beyond our biological families here. Obviously, if you're a parent or you're a grandparent, you do have a primary responsibility to invest in and teach your family about the ways of God. But I want us to look beyond those borders and realize that we have a responsibility to invest in others in the family of God. And to those who don't have children or who are for some reason in a different season of their life, maybe you're widowed or single or in that season of life where you don't have the day-to-day responsibilities of upbringing of offspring, I just want to say what a great, wide, open field of freedom and influence you have. And I encourage you to take full advantage of it. Don't be deterred. Push away every hindrance, because there is no limit to how God can use you to pass on a lasting legacy of faith to those around you. Right throughout the Word of God, from the Old Testament, spanning through the New, we find women actively serving in the kingdom of God. No holds barred, in every capacity, as God gave them an opportunity so that a legacy of living faith would be passed down. Let's turn to the last chapter in the book of Romans, Romans 16. And here we read a long list of people that Paul wants to commend. And among them, surprise, surprise, many women taking primary place. Romans 16, chapter 1. I commend to you Phoebe, our sister, who is a servant of the church in Centuria. Phoebe was a servant, a deacon, a patron of the church. She was a protector, a provider, and a helper of Paul. So we can see a large role here given to her. Verse 2, that you may receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and assist her in whatever business she has need of you. For indeed, she has been a helper of many and of myself too. Verse 3, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who risked their own necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also the churches of the Gentiles. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. So we see Priscilla here. She was a teacher, a prophetess. She hosted a house church. She risked her own life for the sake of Paul. So she must have been doing something pretty important to have come under that kind of, you know, risk and persecution. So working with Paul and a co-labor with him in the kingdom, and many names go on from there. Mary, it says she labored much for Paul. Junia, a notable apostle, obviously not one of the 12 apostles of the Lamb, but nevertheless described in scripture as an apostle. So she was a woman who was moving in the apostolic calling and gifting, and a notable one at that. Then two lovely names, Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labored in the ministry with Paul. So prominent roles of ministry, which Paul found necessary to include in scripture to give them some recognition. And then Rufus's mother, who was not only the mother of Rufus, but obviously who nurtured and mothered Paul. Now, these names and stories are mentioned not because these particular women were somehow more special or more valuable or had some, you know, extra special place in God's heart. These stories are simply there to show us the ways in which God opened doors for women and the way in which they took those opportunities and moved in them. And they are there as examples so that we can also labor in the kingdom of God. The way that Paul speaks about them gives us God's perspective on their ministry. It was a positive one. So we want to go beyond our biological families, beyond those borders, into the wider body of Christ, and ensure that as women, we use every gift, every skill, every opportunity that God has given us so that we can leave this legacy of faith for the next generation. Now, we are gathered here together as women who are anchored to the rock. But you know, it is not enough to be firmly and securely anchored to the rock. I want you to turn to a very important verse in Matthew chapter 21. Matthew 21, verse 44 says, "And whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whom it falls, it will grind him to powder." What does this mean? It is good and well for us to be anchored to the rock. And those who come to the rock voluntarily and fall on the rock, are broken by the rock, will find refuge and healing in him. Their brokenness will be made complete and whole. But this verse also shows us a different side of things, that those who reject it will one day be broken by the stone, because the stone will fall on them and grind them to powder. And this talks about the coming judgment on that final day for those who reject Christ in this life. So I want to challenge us that we will not just be content in being anchored to the rock ourselves, but to realize that we have this responsibility to bring others to the rock so that they might find healing for their brokenness in him in this life, while we still have opportunity. Instead of being broken by the rock on the day of judgment when it will be too late, let us ask God to help us to be fearless, to be secure, and to leave a lasting legacy of faith to the next generation. Shall we pray? I just want to take a moment to pray for each of these things, and I ask that wherever you are listening in today, that you will consider this a sacred moment where God wants to just invade your life and bring you healing and comfort and strengthening. Firstly, I want to ask that God would help us to be fearless women, that we would identify our fears, but we would not let our fears control us, that we will not let our fears cripple us, that we will not let our fears steal away the opportunities that God has given to us and destined for us. I pray that we will be women who look at fear straight in the eyes and decide that despite the fears, we are going to be fearless and walk upon the water. Hallelujah. We can do that because we are anchored to the rock. I want to ask God that he will also help us to lay aside all our insecurities, be it what we look like and what our physical bodies are like, or maybe what our families are and things of our past of which we may be ashamed, but also to come into that security of knowing and finding our place in the kingdom and being comfortable and secure in it, so that we don't have to worry about what anyone else is doing. We don't have to compete with anyone. We don't have to climb over anyone. We don't have to trample anyone. But we feel secure to do what God has called us to do and to support others to do what God has called them to do. And also, I want to ask that he would help us to leave a lasting legacy of faith, that we would not just think about our own families, that we would not be so selfish, but we would open our eyes to the world out there. And we would see that there is a wide open mission field and we are the laborers. We are the laborers. May he send us, may he use us. Lord, thank you that you are present in our midst. Thank you that you love us and that you have called us by name. Thank you, Jesus, that we each have a unique place in your kingdom. We don't have to worry about the others. You have a place carved out for each and every one of us, and it is just our size. Our skills, our talents, our abilities fit uniquely into those opportunities that you have destined for each one of us. And so I pray that you will take the scales off our eyes and help us to see those things, Lord. Help us to see them with our spiritual eyes. And as we see those opportunities, God, help us to be fearless, fearless. Help us to be champions who trample our fears and walk in the purposes of God, not just in our family, but in our workplaces, in our churches, in our communities, in our nations, and in the nations of the world, because truly you are sending us out. And I pray, Lord, that you will help us to be people who intentionally and creatively and sacrificially deposit our faith in others. Help us to be those who bring others to the rock. Help us to be those who teach, who instruct, but most importantly, those who live it out in a concrete and a loving way so that the world will see that we are anchored to you. I commit every precious woman who is participating with us all over the world into your precious hands. In Jesus' name, I pray. Just want to say thank you, Aglow and National Board, for this opportunity. And to Mrs. Vasanthi Jayawardene, special encouragement and honor to you, that the Lord will empower you to walk in your calling and to lead this ministry in your unique style and your unique way, just as God has planned you as a leader for the season ahead. Love you and God bless you.
Hallelujah. Wonderful. Thank you, Pastor Ayesha. I think we all needed to hear this message, to be fearless, to be secure, and to leave a legacy behind to the next generation. Thank you. From the National Board, we want to warmly, warmly bless you, and may the Lord use you mightily across the oceans. Thank you. So at this time, we will be listening to a special, and after the special, the session for the morning will end, and we will have the next session in the evening, local time 6:30. You'll use the same link, and remember, tomorrow too, we have a session in the morning and in the evening. So listen to the numbers and the connection points that are given. We would love to hear from you and take note of them and give us your feedback and reviews. And may you be blessed as you continue to participate and listen in this conference. We truly believe there's something that the Lord is going to make a change, an invasion into your faith life. Amen. And God bless you. May we listen to Melanie Bibile and her team sing the theme song for this conference, Oceans. Listen and be blessed.
Keep my eyes above. when oceans arise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Your grace abounds.